Frida Kahlo was a Mexican woman who transformed her life by painting herself. Born near Mexico City in 1907, on the threshold of the great revolutions of the 20th century, she would improvise her own kind of freedom in order to gracefully transcend a life filled with pain. Crippled at 19 in a terrible accident that left her with permanent injuries, she would begin to paint during her long convalescence and spend the rest of her life articulating her experience into some of the most luminous and haunting images of the age. She would take countless lovers, men and women alike. But the great love of her life was the celebrated Mexican artist, Diego Rivera. The complexity and difficulty of their relationship would dominate her entire adulthood. She herself would become a legend, making her own life into a work of art and coming to feel at home with some of the most celebrated artists and visionaries of her day. And yet, ironically, her paintings would remain virtually ignored during her lifetime, an obscurity that did not matter to her. She painted, she said, for herself, and in the process created some of the most indelible images of the 20th century.
I'm painting a little bit, not because I consider myself an artist or something like that, but simply because I have nothing else to do. And because working, I can forget a little all the troubles I've had. I am doing oils on small plates of aluminum, and sometimes I go to a craft school where I made two lithographs which are absolutely rotten.
In Mexico, they say it's a blessing to be born and to die in the same house. Frida Kahlo was born in Coyoacán, outside Mexico City, in a blue house built by her father. She would live there on and off for the rest of her life and die there just 47 years later. Her father was a German Jewish immigrant, her mother, mostly Indian, from Oaxaca.
Her father was a photographer, and she used to work with him, I mean, to accompany him. And era un epiléptico, he had epilepsy. And she wouldn't say it to others, but she took care of him. And so I think she was aware of what danger means and how short life is and what we all do with our destinies and what we do with our lives and how we live them and how short time is.
When Frida was six, a terrible pain in her right leg was diagnosed as polio. She spent 9 months isolated at home and survived with a limp. It was her father who gently showed her how to overcome teasing and loneliness with what was then considered unladylike behavior. With his encouragement, she swam, boxed, and wrestled.
When she was a young girl, she wanted to have to be a boy. She dressed like a boy. She was someone who was very, very original, very heroic, especially for Mexico, because for a traditional Mexican family to have a girl that dresses like a boy, that puts on a suit, that puts on a cap, that puts on a tie like she did, it must have been quite a shock, especially for that limited mother of hers. And her life was a great, enormous risk, and that she was willing to live it that way, no?
For 400 years, Mexico had been conquered, dominated, invaded, and bloodied by civil war. In the 30 years before Frida's birth, Porfirio Diaz had seized power and forced a troubled peace by crushing all opposition. Finally, 1910, the year that Frida turned three, the Mexican Revolution exploded across the countryside. The revolution was the single most significant impression of Frida's childhood.
The greatest aspect of the Mexican Revolution is that the people arise go on their horses or take trains, and the whole nation travels, moves. The rides of the cavalry of Pancho Villa from the north, of Emiliano Zapata from the south, their convergence in Mexico City and during the childhood of Frida Kahlo was a self-revelation, a form of communion of Mexicans. And so she was part of that and then became part of the mainstream result of the revolution, which was national self-recognition. The great outburst of creativity that came from the Mexican Revolution in painting, in films, in literature, in thought, philosophy, in every single aspect of life and thought. Well, she was in the middle of this vortex of a nation finding out what it looked like.
By 1920, the fighting was over, but the revolution continued to transform the country. One of the intellectual cauldrons of post-revolutionary Mexico was the National Preparatory School. In 1922, Frida became one of the prepa's first female students. At age 15, she was suddenly immersed in the rigors and passions of the finest high school in Mexico City. She learned to read in three languages, fell in love with Whitman and Da Vinci, and dreamed of becoming a doctor. Frida and her friends, a gang of mostly boys who called themselves the Cachuchas, filled the corridors with loud arguments about Marx and religion, Hegel and Kant. They had no tolerance for boredom and once let a donkey into the classroom of a conservative teacher. They even lit fire to the scaffolding beneath the painters who were now transforming the prepa's walls. The school had been chosen as the perfect site for an ambitious, post-revolutionary experiment in public education. The plan was to cover the walls of public buildings with great mural paintings that would tell the newly rewritten stories of the country's history. The murals would narrate Indian mythology, the Spanish conquest, the wonders of industrialization, and the uprising of the working class. Mexico's most promising painters were hired, young men who were eager to leave European traditions behind and find a new, authentically Mexican voice. In keeping with the spirit of their work, they arranged to be paid by the square meter, laborer's wages, and they dubbed themselves the Revolutionary Syndicate of Technical Workers, Painters, and Sculptors. The most prominent member of the syndicate by far was Diego Rivera. Frida was fascinated by Diego. She began to focus her pranks on him, teasing him when his models and girlfriends came and stealing food out of his lunchbox. But her romantic attention was focused on the leader of the Cachuchas, Alejandro Gomez Arias. By the time Frida turned 16, they were madly in love.
Hasta mañana. See you tomorrow. I wish us both a good night. And hope we both think about how great friends should love each other very much, 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 with M as in music or in moon.
Alejandro would later recall that Frida was sexually precocious. To her, he said, sex was a form of enjoying life, a kind of vital impulse. He also claimed that during this time, she was seduced by a woman who worked in the library.
Tell me if you don't love me anymore, Alex. I love you, even if you don't care for me any more than for a flea.
On a rainy fall day in 1925, while she was riding a wooden bus home to Coyoacán with Alejandro, Frida's life, as she had known it, suddenly came to an end. The bus was about to turn a corner when a trolley car collided with it. Alejandro described the accident. Slowly, the trolley pushed the bus. The bus had a strange elasticity. When the bus reached its maximum flexibility, it burst into 1,000 pieces and the trolley kept moving. It ran over many people. Frida lay in the street as a crowd gathered around her. Her spine and pelvis were each broken in three places. Her right leg in 11. Her collarbone and three ribs were also broken, and her right foot was dislocated and crushed. The doctors thought it unlikely that she would survive. Frida had learned as a child to overcome infirmity with physical exertion. Now, forced to lie still, she needed a new way to be active.
Without paying much attention, I began to paint. My obsession was to begin again, painting things just as I saw them with my own eyes, and nothing more. As the accident changed my path, many things prevented me from fulfilling the desires which everyone considers normal. And to me, nothing seemed more normal than to paint what had not been fulfilled.
She had a mirror on her bed. She could see herself. And she painted others, but I think that her main subject was herself. No, she was invaded by herself. No, she was invaded by her own sickness, and what she saw was herself.
She made her first self-portrait for Alejandro. He had distanced himself after finding out about several infidelities before the accident. She wanted her image to linger in his mind.
Alex, though I've said I love you to many and have kissed or been given ribbons by others, at the bottom of my heart, I have only loved you. The portrait will be at your house within a few days. I beg you to put it somewhere low, where you can look at it as if you were looking at me.
Alejandro accepted the gift, and the two reconciled briefly. By 1925, Mexico had emerged from the revolution into a cultural and artistic renaissance. Freed from European pretensions and Catholic morality, Mexico City became a mecca for artists and reformers who were drawn to its refreshing atmosphere. Now 21, Frida was also mostly recovered. Although her injuries would continue to plague her for the rest of her life, she was finally well enough to leave the confines of the Blue House and join in the excitement and vitality of the city.
The city was modernity. Not the place of modernity, but modernity itself. If you live in Mexico City, you are different, because the rest of the country was so oppressed by tradition and customs and prejudices that was impossible to live in.
I knew maiden aunts of mine who would never say buttocks. They would die before saying buttocks. They would say, those on which I sit. Mm-hmm. They would even say legs. Legs was too daring for them. They say, those with which I walk. Things like this, absurdities like this, were part of the formalities of Mexican city middle-class life, against which the lifestyle of Frida Kahlo and Los Cachuchas and Diego Rivera and María Izquierdo and all the rest of them rebelled and said, we're going to be free. We're going to express ourselves freely. We're going to love freely. We're going to create freely. We're going to speak freely. And that was a big break with this puritanical past of semi-colonial Mexico, let's call it.
Frida was now socializing with a loosely knit community of Marxists, communists, anti-imperialists, student leaders, artists, and political exiles. In their company, she rediscovered the pleasure of heated debate, of music, dancing, tequila, and love affairs. At a wild party late one night, Frida noticed Diego Rivera again.
The meeting took place in the period when people carried pistols and went around shooting the street lamps and getting into mischief. Diego shot a phonograph, and I began to be very interested in him, in spite of my fear.
Rivera was the limit. Nobody would transcend Rivera. The society couldn't stand people bolder or freer than Rivera. because he could say, I belong to the Communist Party. He could say, God doesn't exist. Because he could say jokingly that he ate human flesh. Because he could do everything he wanted.
Diego had spent the years of the revolution in Paris studying Cubism. He became a successful Cubist painter and was well respected by his renowned peers, including Picasso. When he returned to Mexico in 1921, the revolution was all but over and the mural project was underway. He reestablished his footing by joining the Mexican Communist Party and quickly became the most prominent of the mural painters. He worked tirelessly. His hulking form could be seen day and night on scaffolds across the city. He left his European subject matter behind and began exploring Mexican images, colors, and themes, eventually pioneering what came to be called the Mexican School. By the time Diego met Frida in 1928, he had left two marriages and three children and had countless affairs. Undeterred by Diego's reputation, Frida decided to bring her paintings to him, to ask if he thought she had any potential as a painter. She carried several canvases to the base of his scaffold and boldly called him down. Diego thought the canvases, like the girl who brought them, were extraordinary. It was obvious to me, he later wrote, that this girl was an authentic artist. A few days later, he traveled out to Coyoacán to see the rest of her paintings. The work, he wrote, her room, her sparkling presence filled me with a wonderful joy. Frida and Diego were an unlikely couple. Frida was 21 and Diego 41. Diego was over 6 feet tall and weighed 300 pounds. Frida was 5'3 and weighed less than 100. But they entertained each other and were never bored together. To her, Diego was the world's greatest artist, the architect of life. To him, she was a diamond in the midst of many inferior jewels. After a brief courtship, Diego asked Frida's father for permission to marry his daughter. Guillermo was broke. He could no longer afford the blue house or Frida's ongoing medical bills. Notice that my daughter is a sick person, he said to Diego. All her life she will be sick. She is intelligent, but not pretty. Think it over. And if you wish to get married, I give you my permission. Their life together was generally filled with tremendous affection and tenderness. One friend remembered how Frida used to listen at the end of each day for Diego's footfall. She would keep very still, and then when she heard him at the door, she would whisper, "There's Diego." He would kiss her fleetingly on the mouth. "How is my little child of my soul?" She treated him like a god. He treated her like a sweet thing. But fidelity was out of the question for him. Once, a doctor had actually told him that he was unfit for monogamy, and he had cheerfully accepted the diagnosis. They had been married less than a year when he had his first affair. Publicly, she struggled to tolerate his behavior. Privately, she was enraged and heartbroken. To make matters worse, she had become pregnant that year and had been forced by medical complications to have an abortion. She began to worry that she would never have a child and that her future with Diego would be filled with heartache.
I cried inconsolably, but I distracted myself by cooking, dusting, sometimes by painting, and every day going to accompany Diego on the scaffold.
During this period, Frida painted, she said, to fill her time. She had no ambition to become an artist or to paint in the style of her husband. Where Diego's work was grand and symbolic, Frida's was intimate and personal, and its natural scale grew smaller and smaller until the paintings were usually less than a foot square. She wasn't interested in epic revisions of Mexican history. Instead, her work reflected the impressions of her childhood, of Mexican folk art, and of the tiny tin ex votos that hung in the Catholic churches and told stories of people who had been saved by miracles. By 1930, the political climate in Mexico had grown cold. Several years of reactionary administrations had already forced most of the muralists off their scaffolds and out of the country. A violent backlash against leftists threatened the labor unions, and communists were being jailed, deported, and even murdered. That fall, Diego was invited to paint several murals in the United States. The timing was perfect, and he liked the idea of creating revolutionary art in what he called the land of the capitalists. Frida had never been outside Mexico, and she thought the trip would be an adventure. In November, they set sail for San Francisco.
San Francisco, January 24, 1931. The city and the bay are wonderful. I don't like the gringos at all. They're very boring, and they've all got faces like unbaked rolls. Diego began to paint 3 days ago. Yesterday, he started at 8:30 and came back at 9 in the morning. He worked more than 24 hours without stopping, without eating or anything. He was exhausted.
San Francisco, they moved on to New York, where Diego had been given a one-man show at Manhattan's Museum of Modern Art. Frida liked New York.
She adored comic films and cartoons, had a great sense of fun, of ribald fun, of saying big words, the so-called dirty words, which are probably the cleanest in the language, of shocking people, of mocking everything around her. Her famous remark to Henry Ford in a dinner in Detroit, knowing that Henry Ford was an anti-Semite, is it true, Mr. Ford, that you were Jewish? Creating these kind of scandals around her. That was part of the great festival of Frida Kahlo, which in a way compensated the intimacy of the pain.
By spring, they were in Detroit, where Diego had been offered a commission to paint a series of murals on the theme of modern industry. Frida was pregnant again. She desperately wanted the baby, but she was afraid that the pregnancy might kill her. Her doctors reassured her that she could have a baby by cesarean, and she began to hope that they were right. But in the middle of a stifling summer night, she started to bleed. She was rushed by ambulance to the Henry Ford Hospital, but the hemorrhaging continued until she lost the baby and nearly died. For 13 sweltering days, she lay in the hospital, overwhelmed with grief. Finally, she asked for a pencil and paper, and she began to discover that she could draw her anguish and then paint it. Never before, said Diego, had a woman put such agonized poetry on canvas as Frida did at this time in Detroit.
Frida found a way of painting pain, of giving her pain through her painting, of seeing, permitting us to see pain, and in so doing, reflecting the pain of the world, of those who could not speak their pain. I think this is a very important aspect of her life and work, that all those marginals, the mutes of the world, in this glossy world we live in which all you see are beautiful people going to film premieres and getting awards, there is this woman who is so broken inside herself, who is so infirm that she has no other beauty to look at except the beauty within herself. Can she find that beauty and bring her out? That is the voyage, the artistic and psychological voyage of Frida Kahlo through pain.
Frida and Diego spent almost 4 years in the United States. She had grown increasingly homesick and had begun to plaster the walls of their hotel rooms with Mexican folk art and newspaper cartoons. Finally, she told her husband that it was time to go home. Diego didn't want to leave. He enjoyed his celebrity in the U.S., and he believed, as he put it, that the world revolution would happen in an industrialized country. He told her that she should sacrifice her desires for the cause. She thought that was bunk. They fought bitterly about what to do, but Diego's money had run out, and in the end, Frida won. A group of friends bought them steamship tickets and sent them home to Mexico.
Diego is weak, thin, yellow, and morally exhausted. If I don't see him happy, I can never be tranquil. And his health worries me more than my own. He thinks that everything that is happening to him is my fault, because I made him come to Mexico.
Despite 2 new mural commissions, Diego was miserable in Mexico, and he took it out on Frida. Within a few months, he'd become infatuated with a new woman. In the past, Frida had protected herself from the hurt of Diego's affairs by believing that the women were beneath her and beneath Diego. This time it was impossible. Diego was having a love affair with her sister, Cristina.
I have never suffered so much, and I did not think I could take so much pain. She was the sister whom I loved the most, and you know what Diego means to me in all senses. He lives a complete life without the stupid emptiness of mine. But I never thought he meant everything to me, and that without him I was worth just trash. Now I see I have no more than any girl disappointed in love whose man has left her.
She cut her hair short and stopped wearing the Mexican clothes that Diego loved. No longer would she try to be attractive for him. She bought a small apartment in the center of Mexico City and moved in with her pet monkey.
My situation seems to me so ridiculous. I've lost my best years being supported by a man, doing nothing else but what I thought would benefit and help him. After 6 years, his answer is that fidelity is a bourgeois virtue and that it exists only to exploit people and to obtain an economic gain.
She now began a new painting, illustrating not only her own pain, but that of a woman she had read about in the newspaper. She also decided that if fidelity was a bourgeois virtue, then she wouldn't be bound by it either. She began to take lovers too, often casually, but occasionally seriously, usually men, but sometimes women. Her view of life, she told a friend, was make love, take a bath, make love again. One of her serious affairs was with a Hungarian portrait photographer named Nicholas Murai. Murai was talented, dynamic, and successful. His pictures of celebrities appeared in Harper's Bazaar and Vanity Fair.
I adore you, my love, believe me, like I never loved anyone. Only Diego will be in my heart as close as you, always.
Even the most serious of Frida's lovers knew that no one could take the place of Diego. When she and Murai broke up, He admitted that he had only filled the bill as a temporary substitute. Of the three of us, he wrote, there were only two of you.
My child, what I would give to see what you are doing now, what you are painting, to be able to be with you and to sleep with you in our little room on the bridge. I so miss your laugh, your voice, your little hands, your eyes, even your tantrums, everything, all of you. You are my life itself, and nothing and no one can change me.
After almost a year of living apart, Frida decided that she would rather live with Diego on his terms in a marriage of mutual independence. She moved back into the home that Diego had built for them in San Angel, a village outside Mexico City next to Coyoacán. It was a modern design with two buildings, a large pink and white one for him and a smaller blue one for her, connected by a bridge on the top floor that Frida could lock from her side. Their lives settled for a while into a routine. Frida reconciled with her sister and spent a lot of time with her niece and nephew.
I wear again my crazy Mexican dress. My hair grew longer again, and I am skinny as always. My character hasn't changed either. I am as lazy as before, without enthusiasm for anything, quite stupid and damn sentimental. Sometimes I think that it's because I'm sick. But of course, that is only a very good pretext.
By the mid-30s, Mexico had again become a hospitable place for liberals and leftists. General Lázaro Cárdenas became president and swept out the repressive regime of his predecessor. Land and labor reforms were resumed, and political activism was on the rise. In Mexico City, communism came into vogue as a way to reinvigorate the reforms of the revolution, and Frida and Diego's home became a hub for an international intelligentsia who thought that Mexico might follow in Russia's footsteps. The Russian Revolution that had begun in 1917 had galvanized a worldwide community of leftists. Although Russians were suffering from famine and tyranny, it looked to the outside world like the peasant masses had succeeded in rising against the rich. Most of the artistic community in Mexico City dreamed of a similar outcome for their own country and passionately supported the Russian Bolsheviks. Frida was an exception. Motivated by a very personal sense of injustice, she became involved instead with Republicans in Spain against Franco, because she believed their cause to be, as she put it, the liveliest and strongest hope to smash fascism in the world.
Frida Kahlo no tuvo ideas políticas. Fue la consorte de las ideas políticas. Pero ella no tiene ideas políticas. Le emocionan las figuras y los símbolos. En un momento Stalin, en otro momento Trotsky, en otro momento Mao Zedong. Pero entonces se decía Mao Zedong. No cree en la política como ideario. Cree en los relámpagos que surgen de las figuras que ennoblecen un mundo marcado por la miseria.
By 1936, Joseph Stalin had consolidated his power in Russia, and he chased his rival, Leon Trotsky, into exile. Communist communities around the world were violently divided in their loyalties. Diego followed Trotsky, alienating himself from the communist mainstream in Mexico. That fall, he went to see President Cárdenas to personally request asylum for Trotsky and his wife, Natalia. Cárdenas agreed, and the Trotskys landed in Veracruz in December. Diego was suffering from kidney problems, and so Frida went in his stead to meet the boat. She brought the Trotskys to the Blue House in Coyoacán, where they would live rent-free under 24-hour guard for the next 2 years. Trotsky was notoriously attracted to pretty women, And Frida found his stature in the world, and in Diego's eyes, appealing. Their interest in each other quickly developed into an affair. But before long, Frida grew tired of Trotsky, whom she called the old man. After their breakup, she made a self-portrait for him, which he left behind when he finally moved from the Blue House.
I have spent my life up until now loving Diego and being a good-for-nothing with respect to work. But now I continue loving Diego. And what's more, I have begun to paint monkeys seriously. Since I came back from New York, I have painted about 12 paintings, all small and unimportant, with the same personal subjects that only appeal to myself and nobody else. Four or five people told me they were super. The rest think they are too crazy.
Early in 1938, at Diego's urging, Frida submitted four paintings to a group show in Mexico City. And for the first time, her work began to attract attention. "She is an excellent painter," wrote one art critic, "of real originality. One of the most interesting Mexican artists I know. Her work looks well beside the best pictures of Orozco and Rivera. In some ways, it is more natively Mexican than theirs." In the spring, André Breton arrived in Mexico. Known in France as the Pope of Surrealism, Breton was the central figure in the most avant-garde art movement of the era. He and his colleagues, Salvador Dali, René Magritte, and others, were exploring Sigmund Freud's new theories of the subconscious. He came to Mexico to visit with Trotsky and to see what he called the surrealist place par excellence. He was not disappointed. In Mexico, he found reality itself to be surreal, and Frida Kahlo's work to be a spontaneous outpouring of pure surreality.
She discovered something that we Latin Americans know very well, and that is that we have lived with surrealism long before the French codified it in the 1920s, after the First World War. The great surrealist artists came from Germany, Max Ernst, from Spain, Luis Buñuel, or from Mexico, Frida Kahlo, because they were connected to a culture that has always known that there is another world besides the world we know. That side by side to the reality we perceive, there is another invisible reality, and that it is the duty of the artist to make that invisibility visible.
They thought I was a surrealist, but I wasn't. I never painted dreams. I paint my own reality.
Shortly after her show in Mexico City, Frida received a letter from Julian Levy, an art dealer in New York who specialized in the surrealists, inviting her to have an exhibition in his gallery. By October, she was in New York without Diego. She told friends she was living her own life. She was treated with respect and affection, not as the wife of the great Rivera, but as a painter in her own right. Her show was a spectacular success. In the winter, she continued on to Paris, where Breton had invited her to show her work. After 3 months away, she was growing homesick for Mexico, and the grim atmosphere of impending war in France did not improve her mood. Worse, she soon discovered that Breton had failed to prepare her show. Her paintings were still being held in customs, and a gallery had never even been arranged.
"I'd rather sit on the floor in the market of Toluca and sell tortillas than to have anything to do with these artistic bitches of Paris. They sit for hours in the cafes warming their precious behinds and talk without stopping about culture, art, revolution, and so on and so forth. Next morning, they don't have anything to eat in their houses because none of them work."
Frida's scorn for her Parisian colleagues was amplified by the fact that she was having another relapse. In addition to chronic pain in her back and foot, she now found herself in the hospital with an infection in her kidneys. When she was released, Several women stepped forward to care for her, including André Breton's wife, Jacqueline Lamba. It was rumored that as she recovered, her warm friendship with Jacqueline developed into a love affair. Finally, Breton's colleague Marcel Duchamp retrieved Frida's paintings and found a gallery to exhibit them. Once again, her show was a great success, and she was received like a celebrity. The fashion designer Elsa Schiaparelli presented a robe Madame Rivera, and Vogue put Frida's hand with all its rings on the cover. Pablo Picasso gave her a pair of earrings in the shape of tiny hands, and the Louvre bought a painting, The Frame. It was the first contemporary Mexican painting in their collection. Frida returned to Mexico in April of 1939. At age 32, she was the toast of the avant-garde art world and an accomplished woman who had navigated New York and Paris without her husband.
My situation with Diego got worse and worse till it came to an end. 2 weeks ago, we began the divorce. I love Diego. You must understand that these troubles will never end in my life. Now I feel so rotten and lonely that it seems to me that nobody in the world has to suffer the way I do.
Again, she cut off her hair and abandoned her Mexican dress. She began drinking as much as a bottle of brandy a day. She also began painting The Two Fridas, the large-scale self-portrait that she said showed the Frida Diego loved and the one he didn't. As during their first separation, they lived apart for almost a year. Diego had an attractive young assistant, and it was rumored that he wanted to marry her. When he left Mexico with her to paint a mural in San Francisco, Frida's health quickly declined.
3 months, I was lying in bed with a plaster corset and an awful apparatus on my chin, which made me suffer like hell. All the doctors in Mexico thought I had to be operated on my spine. I got so scared that I was sure I was going to die. In 3 months, I lost 15 pounds of weight and felt lousy altogether.
In San Francisco, Diego was deeply upset by the news of Frida's illness. He had also begun to regret the divorce. The separation, he said, was having a bad effect on both of us. In fact, he wanted to marry her again. And so Frida went to San Francisco to see a specialist and to consider Diego's request. In the hospital, she thrived under the doctor's care and Diego's renewed affection. Still, she kept him waiting for an answer and instead had an affair with a young German-Jewish refugee named Heinz Berggruen, who was working for Diego. Frida and Heinz traveled to New York and spent a month together in the city. Her health was better, and the affair was a pleasant distraction while she made up her mind. On Diego's 54th birthday, they were remarried in a brief civil ceremony in San Francisco. 2 months later, Diego's murals were completed, and they returned to Mexico.
If I felt better health-wise, one could say that I am happy. But this thing of feeling such a wreck from head to toe sometimes upsets my brain and makes me have bitter moments.
By her 37th birthday, Frida's health was compromising her daily life, and it would decline steadily for the next 10 years. Her spine was so weak, she couldn't sit or stand without support. She was given x-rays, blood transfusions, and spinal taps. Finally, she was put into a metal corset. This corset was the first of 24 that she would wear, most of them made of plaster. She called them punishment. She spent the entire year of 1950 in the English hospital in Mexico City, suffering from headaches, fevers, infections, and gangrene in her foot. She started taking morphine for the pain and began an addiction to painkillers that she was never able to overcome. Frida was now keeping a journal, and it slowly filled up with sketches, watercolors, and free associations that were even more personal than her paintings. More than anything, the journal was a love poem to Diego.
Diego is the name of love. Diego, beginning. Diego, my friend. Diego, my mother. Diego, my father. Diego, my son. Diego, me. Diego, universe.
When she finally moved back into the blue house, it was in a wheelchair. She rarely left home anymore, and for long stretches, couldn't even get out of bed. She dreaded being alone, and her demands and attachments to the people around her grew. She also became ardently communist for the first time. She started a portrait of Stalin and hung a picture of Mao on her bed. To her, communism had become confused with community, and she believed that it would protect her from being alone.
Revolution is the harmony of form and color, and everything exists and moves under only one law, life. Nobody is separate from anybody else. Nobody fights for himself. Everything is all and one. Anguish and pain, pleasure and death, are no more than a process for existence.
I don't think Frida was a communist. I think that Frida was a pantheist. I think Frida was in love with the world, with everything that was alive. Her love for the little dogs and the flowers and the monkeys and all the things that appear in her painting. She sort of sacralizes the world. She wants to sacralize everything she touches. She is she's in love with the world as garden.
In spite of my long illness, I feel immense joy in living.
In the spring of 1953, Frida's dear friend, Lola Alvarez Bravo, who ran an art gallery in Mexico City, decided to exhibit Frida's work. Despite her celebrity in international circles, she had never had a show at home. It was clear that Frida was near death, and Bravo wanted to honor her during her lifetime.
She arrived like that, like a tragic and beautiful figure, but she arrived like that, and she made an entrance, which was that, I think it must have been very, very, well, very important for the people who saw her, no? Like seeing someone who's resurrected, who has a resurrection. I think she believed in resurrection. She was always giving life to herself, like out of her own ashes, no?
Friends, students, critics, and strangers crowded around her bed all evening. It was a huge party, with tequila, laughter, guitars, and singing. It was, one friend put it, the kind of performance that she loved, colorful, surprising, intensely human, and a little morbid. Bravo received calls from Paris, London, and across the U.S. asking about the show. A prominent critic summarized the experience. It is impossible to separate the life and work of this singular person. Her paintings are her autobiography. Two months later, Frida's doctors decided that they would have to amputate the bottom half of her right leg. "She is going to die," Diego said. "This is going to kill her." "The night before the operation," wrote her nurse, "it was just silent. We didn't say a single word. All the days after the operation, it was silent. Just silence." Following the surgery, Frida spoke little. She lay or sat near the large window in her bedroom and watched the pigeons and branches and fountain moving in the garden. Her last painting was a lavish still life of cut watermelons. 8 days before she died, she inscribed the bottom with her name, the date, and the place, Coyoacán, Mexico. Then she wrote in large letters her parting words, Viva la vida. Long live life.
I hope the leaving is joyful, and I hope I never return.
On Tuesday, July 13th, 1954, Frida Kahlo died in her bed. She was 47 years old. Her friends tied up her hair with flowers and ribbons and put on her rings and necklaces. People filed past the bed all day long to pay their respects. Diego, a friend recalled, became an old man in a few hours, pale and ugly. When Frida died, he looked like a soul cut in two. Diego only lived 3 years after Frida's death. He admitted that it was only after she died that he finally understood the power of her love. His final statement as a painter was a small still life of cut watermelons.
Lot 25, and $850,000 to start.
$900,000, $150,000.
$1 million. On the telephone now at $1 million. At $1 million, $1,100,000. $1,200,000 and eight. At $1,200,000. $1,200,000. On the telephone, it's against you in the room. Selling here. $1,200,000.